from a guest from France. And I think it was really very much appreciated. We have our last speaker, and I can only add my own words to our previous speaker in thanking the audience for their patience and their stamina in lasting until now. It's really remarkable. I'm looking at all the faces. Everyone's wide awake and paying attention. So I can see everyone. So we now come to our last speaker, Mr. Anton Klopkov, who is the former executive director of the PRI Center in Moscow and now director for energy and security studies at that center, a graduate of Moscow Engineering Physics Institute. His main research area is, again, weapons of mass destruction, WMD, non-proliferation. He has authored a number of books, The Iranian Nuclear Program and U.S.-Russian Relations, Nuclear Non-Proliferation and U.S.-Russian Relations, Challenges and Opportunities, and also International Programs Assisting Russia's Disarmament and Non-Proliferation Efforts. And the topic he's going to speak about, I think, is called Nuclear Factor in Russian-Iranian Relations After the Revolution. And I imagine that you're also going to speak. I think the topic we can also take upside down and say Russian relations as the main factor in the nuclear issue in Iran, Russian-Iranian relations. So this works both ways. And we all know that the Russian factor, as was mentioned, Emily mentioned it before and others mentioned it, is a key factor, and this came out from the words we heard before from Dr. Delbesh, also is a key factor in dealing with the nuclear factor in Iran. So we'll be very happy to hear from Professor Klopkov. The floor is yours on this issue.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to all of us for still being in this conference room. I would like to start my presentation with a few historical points, because I think that the history of Iranian nuclear program influence a lot on the current situation as well. And for example, we are in Russia feel that sometimes our negotiations with Iran on details of Bushehr, spent nuclear fuel, is influenced quite significantly by the previous Iranian experience in the nuclear sphere during Shah period, from the Shah period as well. And for example, when we offer something to Iran, and this is the case for Russia as well, we should well remember the previous experience. For example, Iranian experience in participation in multinational enrichment facility in France. Another project was multinational reprocessing facility, which was offered by the United States and was negotiated for a number of years. And we know well that even that time, during Shah period, Iran did not accept any kind of multinational participation in nuclear fuel cycle activity in Iran. So I would say, I will start with a few historical points on Shah Iran and Soviet Union, even not cooperation, but dialogue on nuclear issues. And there were three dimensions of the nuclear factor 30 years ago, or even 40 years ago. First of all, it's a peaceful nuclear program. Second, nuclear proliferation. And the third one, it was a very important issue for the Soviet Union in 60s and even 50s. It's deployment of foreign nuclear weapons in Iran. It was a big deal for Russia and that time Soviet Union to prevent deployment of U.S. nuclear weapons in Iran. It is interesting that in spite of the fact that relation of the Soviet Union and Shah Iran was not good enough. Soviet Union was trying to establish peaceful nuclear cooperation even that time. And, for example, Shah, during one of his trips to Russia, visited the first nuclear power plant, which was built in the Soviet Union in Kaluga region. The Soviet Academy of Science were trying to establish cooperation in the nuclear area with their counterparts in Iran. And 1972 Soviet-Iranian agreement on development of economic and technical cooperation covered, among other energy issues as well. But at that time, Soviet Union was not successful in establishment of cooperation with the nuclear area, and we know that Germany and France were most successful in this area. Another factor that time, which was quite significant for the Soviet Union, as I mentioned before, to prevent deployment of U.S. nuclear weapons in Iran, because in 1959 U.S. nuclear weapons was deployed in Turkey, and there were big concerns in the Soviet Union that Iran could be another place where U.S. nuclear weapon will be introduced. But finally, in 1962, Russia, Soviet Union, and Iran agreed that Iran will not provide its territory for deployment of foreign missile military bases, and it will help a lot for two countries to expand its economic relation in the future as well, but as I mentioned before, not in the nuclear area. And I would say that until 1974, when Iran publicly announced its huge program on development of nuclear energy, nuclear non-proliferation with regard to Iran was not a concern in the Soviet Union, in spite of the fact, and we should keep it in mind, that, for example, Iran participated as observer in U.S. nuclear tests. We should keep in mind that Iranians participated as observers in two nuclear tests, recently in North Koreans, and in 1958 in U.S. one. And in spite of the fact that during visit to India, the head of Atomic Energy Organization of Iran, Dr. Etemad, has made a comment in favor on peaceful nuclear explosions. It was in 1974. In spite of these facts, in the Soviet Union, Iran was not considered as a non-proliferation concern, I would say, until mid of 70s, because in addition to 23 nuclear power plants, which was planned to build in Iran that time, Iran was going to establish the closed nuclear fuel cycle, including reprocessing, including spent nuclear fuel storage, and some other facilities which have dual use application. And especially Russia was against reprocessing in Iran because shortly after Indian test in 1974, the nuclear suppliers group start discuss so-called NSG guidelines, and Soviet Union was advocating the ban for export of any sensitive nuclear technology, including enrichment and reprocessing, but finally countries was not able to adopt that. And another concern which Russia, Soviet Union has that time, it's Iranian plans to construct nuclear power plants at the Caspian Sea. The problem was that it's quite seismic territory, and it was the question of safety of this kind of nuclear power plant for the Soviet Union. After the revolution, of course, the kind of cooperation between Russia and initially Soviet Union and Iran in the nuclear sphere has changed, but not from the very beginning, because firstly, as we know well, the nuclear program of Iran after the revolution was frozen, and secondly, the Soviet Union was not at the first page of the Iranian list of nuclear suppliers, since initially new Iranian government was trying to reestablish cooperation with those countries which cooperated with Shah regime, like Germany and others. In 1989, it was the first Soviet, that time Soviet-Iranian document on nuclear cooperation. It was a part of joint program for economic trade and scientific cooperation. And in 1992, two countries signed an umbrella agreement for nuclear cooperation, and the contract for Bushehr nuclear power plant construction was signed in 1995. The same year, the contract for nuclear fuel delivery was signed, and just in 10 years, in 2005, in February, two countries signed a protocol on returning of spent nuclear fuel to Russia. So from non-proliferation point of view, at least in the Russia these days, there are no concern that Bushehr nuclear power plant in any kind could assist Iran to cross the line, and that either the uranium from the fuel could be used for some undeclared purposes, or spent nuclear fuel could be used for military purposes, because we know that light water reactors, which is constructed in Bushehr and probably will be operational early next year, is not sufficient for military purposes. What was the reason for the Russian Federation to establish nuclear cooperation with Iran in mid of 90s? First of all, and I think it was the main reason, to support its nuclear industry, I mean Russian nuclear industry, and keeping nuclear experts busy. Because on the eve of the collapse of the Soviet Union, more than 1 million people were working in the nuclear industry, and most of them stayed in Russia after collapse of the USSR. And Iranian contract for Bushehr was the first one which was signed by Russia for construction of nuclear power plant abroad. So it was very significant financial assistance for the Russian nuclear industry, in spite of the fact that the initial price for the project was quite modest. If we will compare with the current prices for nuclear power plants, it was about $800 million. Now, the nuclear power plant of 1,000 megawatt cost, I think, at least $3 billion. And the very important issue that time for Russia was that Iran agreed to pay 80% in cash, not in oil, not in goods, not in pistachios, but by cash. You know, for the Russian economy in early 90s, it was a big deal. And I just mentioned that totally in the Bushehr project, about 300 companies and about 20,000 Russian specialists participated. So you could imagine what is the size of this contract. So this peaceful nuclear cooperation is one of the dimensions of nuclear dialogue, nuclear-related dialogue between Russia and Iran. Because, of course, there is another one, which is related to Iranian covert nuclear activity, which was discovered in 2002. And I could tell you that it was a bad surprise for Russia, if not a shock, when these two facilities in Iraq and Natanz was disclosed, because especially in 90s, quite a number of people were quite naive especially in the nuclear industry in Russia, they did believe that if we cooperate with Iran and Bushehr, we will have more information what is going on in the nuclear industry in Iran. So it was bad surprise for Russia, and as a quick reaction, Russia slowed down the construction of nuclear power plant in Bushehr. It was a bad surprise, but some concern in Iran, concerns in Russia on Iranian nuclear activity were before that. For example, in 1993, the Russian Foreign Intelligence Service published an open report, and it was mentioned that time, so 1993, that Iran has a nuclear research program with some military applications. So there were some concerns that time as well. And another problem related to nuclear cooperation with Iran that time was to prevent unauthorized cooperation between Russian nuclear scientists and Russian nuclear industry organizations with Iran, because a number of Iranian diplomats, scientists, journalists visited Russia that time, visited Russian facilities and offered cooperation in the nuclear area, sometimes with no authorization from Russian authority. So it was a huge problem for Russia that time, and Federal Security Service of Russia spent a few years to identify those Iranian people and organizations which were actively working in Russia and who were trying to engage Russian scientists and companies in missile, first of all, and some of them in nuclear cooperation as well. So what is Russian understanding of the current situation with regard to Iran? First of all, there is no doubt that Iran violated its obligation under IAEA safeguards agreement. But the important issue that our goal, or if you like, our approach, should be not to punish Iran, first of all, but to investigate all details of the past Iranian nuclear activity and to expand IAEA control over Iranian nuclear activity. Sometimes it looks like in the past, during the last few years, the main goal, especially in the U.S., was not to investigate what Iran was doing in the nuclear area, but first of all, to punish Iran, to limit Iranian right to develop some stages of nuclear fuel cycle, to persuade Iran to accept zero enrichment, et cetera, et cetera. If this will be the option for the next round of consultation or negotiations, I think it will be no result. So Iranian program should be more transparent, no question of that, but Iran still has a right for nuclear energy development. What are the main reasons for Russia to have special, if you like, policy vis-a-vis Iran, different from EU free and different from the US? You could often find in the media or even in the analysis provided by non-proliferation experts that economic cooperation with Iran is among the key drivers for Russia. I think this is a wrong approach. First of all, because economic cooperation between Russia and Iran is quite limited. It was during the last 3 or 4 years, annual cooperation was about $2 billion. So it's for current Russian economy, it's like nothing. Last year, it was about $3 billion, but it's still 10 times less than, for example, EU Iran bilateral cooperation. This is why Russia do not have economic tool on Iran, or it's quite limited. And the main reason for Russia to have a, I would say, special approach on Iran is a common security, are the common security interests in Iran, with Iran, first of all, in the Russian neighborhood. It's Central Asia, Caspian region, Caucasus. And you could make your conclusion how Russian policy on Iran has changed during the last few years when U.S., first of all, expanded its activity in the Russian neighborhood, in the Caucasus and the Central Asian Caspian region. And I think it will continue to be the main driver for Russian-Iranian cooperation in any of spheres, including in the nuclear one. But it does not mean that Russian position, Russian approach, do not have some flexibility. At the same time, we should not overestimate this flexibility. For example, I think about 6 weeks ago, there were a number of speculations in the media about possible change of Iran for missile defense in Europe. So Russia will limit its cooperation with Iran in some areas, and for that, U.S. will not deploy missile defense in Europe. I think there is no real base for these speculations, because both issues, missile defense and cooperation between Russia and Iran, is quite important for Russia. But it does not mean that Russia will be ready to stop its cooperation with Iran, for example, in Bushehr, especially when the fuel was supplied there. And these two quite important issues should be addressed separately. And I just want to mention one more point, that in 2006, when Russia for the first time was president in G8, addressing Iranian nuclear crisis was the Russian priority, I think, for this year. And Russia offered a multinational facility to Iran, I mean, the multinational enrichment facility in Angarsk, in Siberia, in addition to those enrichment capabilities which exist in Iran. The idea was that having this multinational center, probably Iran will limit its enrichment activity on its own territory. I think it was a wrong, it's my personal view, it was a wrong idea, and this idea did not take into consideration the previous Iranian experience when Iran participated in multinational enrichment facility in France. But this initiative is still on the table. I could not exclude that it could be a small part of the big package if one day it will be achieved. But I will remember again my point that we should not ask Iran for zero enrichment, because it is difficult for me to imagine who will accept in Iran this approach and give up all enrichment activity which exists in the country. So another point which is important now for Russian-Iranian cooperation, that Bushehr project is not critical for Russian nuclear industry anymore, as you could imagine. Because since early 90s, the financing from the state budget of this of the industry has increased significantly, and now Russia has a number of other projects abroad in Bulgaria, China, India, And it's mean that there is more flexibility from Russian side when we cooperate with Iran, but we should not, Russia should not be asked to stop construction works in Bushehr if there are no any new evidences that Iran continues its military nuclear program. Which is important for Russia now to depoliticize Bushehr project and to convert it to a business format. I mean that joint operation, supply of fresh fuel, return of spent fuel, so it business as usual with no influence of politics on cooperation in this area, because as of now, the profit of the project for Russia is quite questionable. As I mentioned at the beginning, so the initial price was about $800 million. So since then, the components for nuclear power plants, which are bought not only from Russia, but from some European countries as well, has increased significantly. So for Russia, it's quite important to start annual delivery of fuel to Iran just to earn some money to cover those expenses which was made by Russia within this project. A few final words how the possible solution could look like and what is the possible Russian approach. First of all, my impression that Iranian progress in the nuclear fuel cycle is quite exaggerated. It is exaggerated by Iranians themselves and by foreign media as well. For example, Ahmadinejad recently stated that Iran has about 7,000 centrifuges, which are operational. And at the same time, according to the recent IAEA report, they have about 4,000. And we know well that Iran has a number of difficulties how to operate these centrifuges, a number of problems with efficiency of centrifuges. And this is why from time to time Iran is trying to invent so-called new types of centrifuges. So initially it was P1, then P2, then IR2, etc., etc. So from my point of view, it means that they are not able to handle efficiently those centrifuges which they have, so they are trying to develop some new types from new materials, new components, etc. So it means that we have some time to negotiate the deal, but of course the clock is ticking, and we should not waste our time as we did in the past, because there were a few options in the past when we could reach a kind of agreement with Iran. And for example, during EU-free Iranian negotiations, Iran offered, it was Iranian offer to limit their enrichment capability with just 16 centrifuges. So this proposal was not accepted. Now Iran has about 4,000, as I mentioned before. And as I mentioned before, we should not also dream and expect that Iran will agree so-called zero enrichment option, so no enrichment in Iran. I think we should try to negotiate what will be the scope of this enrichment. At the same time, it's clear for me that with no foreign significant assistance, Iran will not be able to construct industrial-scale enrichment facility, which was initially proposed up to 50,000 centrifuges. So another important area to deal with non-proliferation problem is to prevent any additional assistance to Iran, either from North Korea or from Pakistan, first of all, because in Pakistan it was a HEU bomb, in North Korea it's a plutonium bomb, so we know that in Iran, Iran is quite far from plutonium one because heavy water reactor is just under construction, but they have already had some centrifuges, so if they decide to create the bomb, so probably the first one could be uranium one. Yeah, just the last point. And until recently, U.S. was a part of the problem, but not a part of solution of Iranian nuclear program. And of course, the new administration raised a high expectation in U.S. raised high expectation around the world and in Russia as well. But we should wait. What will be the U.S. policy, what will be U.S. approach on Iran. Some positive signals were sent from U.S. to Iran, but as of now, there is no even the nuclear non-proliferation team within State Department, which will be dealing with Iranian issues. So we should wait, and we'll see what will be U.S. approach, because it is an open secret that the main part of the package which could be agreed on with Iran is not in Moscow or Beijing. It is in the in U.S., in Washington. Thank you.
I'd like to thank Professor Klopko for very, very important insights on the Russian thinking on this issue. It raises many questions in my mind, I'm certain in other people's minds, but it was very important, I think, to hear from an authoritative source as he is with his knowledge of these insights and the way he sees the Russian perception, both of the issue as it is now and the prognosis for the future and possible solutions.